Good evening. Back in the book of Matthew. We read chapter 11 last night, and John the Baptist was in prison, and he was saying, is this it? Is this the time that Christ has come for the eternity to set up? Or do we look for a second advent? Because he knew from the scriptures there would be a second advent. And we learned that Christ is teaching that John the Baptist came not eating and drinking, and they beheaded him. Then Christ came, he was eating and drinking, he was eating and drinking with the sinners, trying to save them, and he was crucified. So what Christ is teaching is that no matter what you do, you will be hated if you teach God's word. And then he goes on to say, Christ says, woe to Chorazin and Bethsaida, because Christ was right there teaching them. And then Christ says, it will be more tolerable for Sodom in the day of judgment than it is for you. Because in Sodom and Gomorrah, they didn't have Christ right in front of them teaching. Even though the horrible abominations that they committed, Christ says it will be more tolerable for them in the day of judgment. Because you saw Christ right in front of you and you refused to accept him. He goes on to say that he says, take my yoke. And we know that yoke, like on a horse, is the collar that keeps the reins from digging into them. Christ says, I am that yoke for you. Lay your burdens on me and you will have peace. You will have wisdom. You will have the love and the calmness that the love of Christ gives you. And it's saying that those of you that are heavy laden, and we learn that the Greek word, it means to be overburdened with ceremony. Those that their ceremonies are so religious, it seems so holy, but they never get around to teaching God's word. He's saying, come unto me, learn in my word. Come to learn the word from the very good book. And you will be have such a much better and easier life when you learn directly from God's word instead of the traditions of men. We got a little bit into chapter 12, and we're gonna back up just a little bit so we can get to the subject that we were on. So let's ask the word of wisdom.
Dear Father in heaven, Yahweh, we thank you for bringing us together and giving us this building that we can share your word. And we ask you to give us eyes to see and ears to hear so we can understand your word and share it with others. And we ask you to bring us the wisdom we need so we can understand your word. Thank you, Father. In Jesus, Yeshua's precious name, amen. So we're in Matthew 12. We're going to pick it up verse 9 so we can get the subject. And
remember, the scribes and the Pharisees, they're saying, oh, is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath day? They're saying, you guys shouldn't be doing this stuff on the Sabbath. Let's learn what Christ says.
Matthew chapter 12, verse 9. And when he was departed thence, he went into their synagogue, and behold, there was a man which had his hand withered. And they asked him, saying, is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath days? That they might accuse him.
Trying to trip him up, trying to get him to break a law so they can turn him over and to have him killed. That's their plan.
Verse 11. And he said unto them, what man shall there be among you that shall have one sheep, and if it fall into a pit on the Sabbath day, will he not lay hold on it and lift it out?
Because their sheep, that was their prophet. He's saying, I know that if one of your sheep falls into a pit, you're going to go get him, even if it's on the Sabbath, because all you care about is money.
Then what does he say? Verse 12. How much then is a man better than a sheep? Wherefore it is lawful to do well on the Sabbath days.
It is lawful to do good on every day. And we do know from Hebrews chapter 4 that Jesus Christ became our Sabbath when he died on the cross. So every day is the Sabbath day. We don't take days off when it comes to spreading God's word, when it comes to doing righteous acts. There is no day off. Every day is the Sabbath for us because Jesus Christ is our Sabbath.
Verse 13. Then saith he to the man, stretch forth thine hand. And he stretched it forth, and it was restored whole like as the other.
Healed his hand right there, perfect, just as his other one.
Verse 14. Then the Pharisees went out and held a council against him, how they might destroy him.
They want to kill Christ. And they're so caught up on the law, remember? They're saying, oh, is this lawful? Is that lawful? Apparently, they forgot the Ten Commandments, thou shalt not murder. Because that's what they're seeking to do. They're seeking to murder him. And as we're going to get through this chapter 12, you're going to see it's really all setting us up for chapter 13. That's the parable of the sower. And it's written in Mark chapter 4. It says, if you don't understand this parable, how are you going to understand any of the parables? So this is setting us up very well for Matthew chapter 13, a very important chapter.
Verse 15. But when Jesus knew it, he withdrew himself from thence, and great multitudes followed him, and he healed them all,
Christ got things done. That's why everyone was following him. He was performing these miracles, healing the sick. The scribes and the Pharisees couldn't do that. He's pulling them all out of their churches and coming into the true church of Christ.
Verse 16, and charged them that they should not make him known.
It wasn't time yet for Christ to be necessarily revealed as the Messiah, for him to be crucified as it was written of long ago. Even in Psalms 22, 1,000 years before the fact, it was prophesied.
Verse 17, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by Isaiah, that's to say Isaiah the prophet, saying, behold my servant whom I have chosen, my beloved, in whom my soul is well pleased. I will put my spirit upon him, and he shall show judgment to the Gentiles.
Remember, Christ is not only the Savior of Israel. He's the Savior of all nations, the Savior of all people. After the sixth day, when Christ created all the races, he said, God looked back and he said, it was very good. He's the Savior to all people.
Verse 19, he shall not strive nor cry, neither shall any man hear his voice in the streets.
This is to say, he does not go and make a huge show when he's teaching. He's not screaming in the streets. Look how gentle Jesus Christ is in this next verse, verse 20.
A bruised reed shall he not break, and smoking flax shall he not quench, till he send forth judgment unto victory.
A bruised reed, that's just a little leaf off a plant that's already broken. This is saying Christ is so gentle in his ministry, that reed is not even going to break. You plant the seed, God makes the seed grow. Don't be overbearing on someone. And the smoking flax, that's to say a little wick on a lantern. And he's saying that he can clip the wick without even making the fire go out. He is that gentle with his ministry. You plant seeds in love and in gentleness, or no one is going to listen to you.
Verse 21, and in his name shall the Gentiles trust or hope.
In his name, the Gentiles do hope because he is the Savior to all people.
Verse 22. Then was brought unto him one possessed with a devil, blind and dumb. And he healed him, insomuch that the blind and dumb both spake and saw.
And remember, all throughout Christ's ministry, you want to think physically, but also spiritually. He did heal this man to where he could actually see, he could actually hear. But remember, spiritually, he gave people eyes to see and ears to hear so they can understand God's word and so they will not be deceived.
Verse 23, and all the people were amazed and said, is not this the son of David? What this is really saying is they're saying, could this actually be the Messiah? Of course it was. Verse 24, but when the Pharisees heard it, they said, this fellow doth not cast out devils, but by Beelzebub, the prince of the devils.
Beelzebub, that's to say, Lord of the flies or Lord of the dunghill. And we know that Beelzebub, that's even a type for Satan. Who is the king over the devils? Revelation chapter 9, verse 11, it gives you his name in both the Hebrew and the Greek, Abaddon and Apollyon. It says he is the king of the bottomless pit, the ruler over the fallen angels. So that's, you know that Satan is the king of the devils. They're saying that, oh, this guy's just casting out devils by the devil.
How ridiculous is that statement? Look what Christ says, verse 25. And Jesus knew their thoughts and said unto them, every kingdom divided against itself is brought to desolation, and every city or house divided against itself shall not stand. And if Satan cast out Satan, he is divided against himself. How shall then his kingdom stand?
It can't, and of course we know the day will come when Satan's kingdom will no longer stand, praise God. Because remember, he is the prince of the air. He's the prince of this world. The evil spirits roam in and out of this world, and he is the prince of this world. When he will set himself up as prince of princes, king of kings, when he comes claiming to be God. When the true Christ returns, that will all be done away with forever.
Verse 27. And if I by Beelzebub cast out devils, by whom do your children cast them out? Therefore they shall be your judges.
They could not cast demons out because they didn't have the love of Jesus Christ in their hearts. Remember Luke chapter 10 verse 19, it says, you have the power to cast out demons through the name of Christ. They didn't have Christ, therefore they couldn't do it.
Verse 28. But if I cast out devils by the Spirit of God, then the kingdom of God has come unto you.
And it did come unto them. Remember, we know Jesus Christ is Emmanuel, God with us. God came in the flesh. The kingdom was right there in front of them, yet they refused to listen.
Verse 29. Or how else can one enter into a strong man's house and spoil his goods, except he first bind the strong man, and then he will spoil his house?
Remember, you have power over even Satan himself. Nothing can come against you when you have the love and the knowledge of Jesus Christ. So that's saying that when it comes to Satan's house, the evil that he brings, you have the power to bind Satan through the name of Christ, so nothing he can do can come against you.
Verse 30, very important verse. He that is not with me is against me, and he that gathereth not with me scattereth abroad.
And there's going to be some verses here coming up, and it's really going to be directed towards people that claim to be teachers, claim to be men of the cloth. And this is saying either you gather with me, either you teach the true word of God, you plant seeds of truth, or you scatter it. You're just going to scatter everyone abroad because they don't know who to listen to. They try to listen, people try to listen to what man says, but the truth never comes through to them because the only thing that changes lives is God's word, not the truth of men. There is no truth in man.
There's only the truth of the word of God. Verse 31. Wherefore I say unto you, all manner of sin and blasphemy shall be forgiven unto men, but the blasphemy against the Holy Spirit shall not be forgiven unto men.
Whoa, what's this talking about? Don't worry, we're going to learn.
Let's keep reading, verse 32. And whosoever speaketh a word against the Son of Man, it shall be forgiven him. But whosoever speaketh against the Holy Spirit, it shall not be forgiven him, neither in this world, neither in the world to come.
Now, if you don't know what this talk is talking about, you might be like, oh, I hope I haven't blasphemed the Holy Spirit. I hope I haven't committed this sin. Don't worry, no one has committed this sin yet, and hopefully no one ever will. And this is specified so much more in detail in Luke chapter 12. I'm going to turn there because what this is talking about is when you're delivered up before the false Messiah. And if we were just to read that, people might be like, oh, how do you know that? That doesn't say anything about that. All right, let's turn to Luke chapter 12 so we can really nail this down and you can know exactly what this is talking about. Picking it up in Luke chapter 12, verse 10. Same subject.
And whosoever shall speak a word against the Son of Man, it shall be forgiven him.
Anything you have said in the past, no matter how bad it might have been, even toward God, you ask for repentance of your sins and you actually mean it, you will be forgiven. That sin is washed away as if it never existed.
But unto him that blasphemeth against the Holy Spirit, it shall not be forgiven. Now, when we come to verse 11, he explains when this can be committed. Verse 11. And when they shall bring you unto the synagogues, and unto magistrates and powers, take ye no thought how or what thing ye shall answer, or what ye shall say. For the Holy Spirit shall teach you in the same hour what ye ought to say.
When this is written of in Mark chapter 13, it says, do not even premeditate what you will say. And this, like it says, if you blaspheme the Holy Spirit, if you refuse the Holy Spirit to speak through you, that is unforgivable and you will be damned to hell. Even the 1,000 teaching period can't save you. And that is why, like it's written in Isaiah chapter 29, verse 10, God puts the spirit of slumber on people. Because when Satan is here claiming to be God, if you do know that he is Satan and you are delivered up for that witness against him and you refuse this, then you're damned forever. So God puts the spirit of slumber on people so they cannot commit this sin. Some people can't handle the truth. They can't handle. Because remember, Satan comes performing miracles. He's going to do. You have to be ready for anything. Because his miracles and deception are so great. So God puts the spirit of slumber on people so they cannot commit this sin. When you are delivered up for that witness, because you are going to stand against the false Messiah, you know he comes first. It says, do not even premeditate what you will say. The Holy Spirit will speak through you and your destiny will be fulfilled.
Let's go back to Matthew. Matthew chapter 12, verse 33. Either make the tree good and its fruit good, or else make the tree corrupt and its fruit corrupt. For the tree is known by its fruit.
This can go all the way back to Genesis chapter 3. What did we have in the garden? You have the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. That's Satan. And then you have the tree of life, that is Jesus Christ. You know people by their fruits. How do they act? What do they teach? That is how you know. And you might say, oh, you're looking pretty deep into that, aren't you? Well, read what the next verse says. Remember, I said this is setting up the parable of the sower perfectly so that you can't miss what this is talking about, and especially in the next chapter. Verse 34. O generation of vipers, how can ye, being evil, speak good things? That word generation is genema, and it means offspring. It doesn't mean a generation as in a certain period of time, people that are alive. This means offspring. This is exactly how John the Baptist identified them back in chapter 3 when he was baptized and they came to him. He said, why are you here, generation of vipers? He knew who they were. He knew Satan was their father and that wickedness is in them. We know that Cain was the son of Satan, and that's why he killed Abel, because that wickedness was in him. This is the offspring of the serpent. You know, a viper is a serpent, a poisonous snake or an adder. The serpent is the devil, Revelation chapter 12, verse 9. For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. Sooner or later, the truth's going to come out about how you really feel, what's actually in your heart. Yeah, that people can play church as long as they want. But sooner or later, when the truth, remember, the word of God is a two-edged sword dividing the spirit asunder. So when the truth of God comes to some people, well, to anyone, the truth is going to come out. What is in your heart will come out of your mouth sooner or later. Verse 35. A good man out of the good treasure of the heart bringeth forth good things, and an evil man out of the evil treasure bringeth forth evil things. Verse 36. But I say unto you, that every idle word that men shall speak, they shall give account thereof in the day of judgment. Remember, I said these verses are going to be kind of directed at teachers or people that claim to be. This word is argos, and it means inactive, it means lazy or useless. If you are speaking idle words, if you are claiming to be a teacher of God's word, and you just maybe teach one or two verses instead of teaching what the word of God says, you are going to be judged by that big time, and it is not going to be good for you if you keep the word of God from others. Remember, 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 17 says judgment starts at the house of God and begins at the pulpit. So if you claim to be a teacher, you better know exactly what you're talking about, and you better be teaching directly from God's word, or the wrath of God is going to come down on you.
Verse 37, for by thy words thou shalt be justified, and by thy words thou shalt be condemned. What do you teach? Do you teach God's word, or do you think that God's word is too boring? So you get up there and you just start telling some story that you think people are as interesting. Why people think they're more interesting than God, I will never understand. The Word of God is so exciting, it moves when you teach it as it is written. Verse 38. Then certain of the scribes and of the Pharisees answered, saying, Master, we would see a sign from thee. They want a sideshow. Remember when we went to 1 Chronicles chapter 2, verse 55? Remember, that whole chapter, it's detailing the tribes of Judah. But then when you get to verse 55, it nails it. It is so easy to understand. It spells it out for you. It says these scribes are the Kenites. Kenites, that is to say, when you look up the word Kenite 7017, it will say patronymic of 7014, which is the word for Cain. Patronymic means offspring. So when you look up that word and you know the definition, you know the Kenites are the offspring of Cain. That was the first murderer, the son of Satan himself. So these are the Kenites that are speaking here. They're saying, we would see a sign from thee. Exactly what Satan said to Christ in chapter 4 when he was tempting him. He said, just throw yourself off this mountain, God will save you. Come on, prove to me that you're Jesus Christ. They learned very well from their father, the devil. Verse 39, but he, Christ, answered and said unto them, an evil and adulterous generation seeketh after a sign, and there shall no sign be given to it, but the sign of the prophet Jonas, that's to say Jonah. Verse 40, for as Jonah was 3 days and 3 nights in the whale's belly, or the fish, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth.
And it is true that Jonas was in the fish for 3 days and three nights, and he would come up out of that. We know Christ was in, he was dead for 3 days, or his flesh was dead. But when you study Jonah, the book of Jonah, a little deeper, you come to realize the entire book of Jonah is a sign for Christ. At the very beginning, he's in the ship and he's sleeping, just as Christ was in the ship. They go to wake him up and they say, "Oh, what's going on? We need you to call to your God to save us." Basically, exactly what they were saying to Jesus Christ when he was asleep on the ship. And then as it goes on, you learn why Jonah did not want to go to Nineveh. It's because he learned the prophecy of God's word that the Ninevites would eventually, they would take over Israel, Jonah's people. He was willing to die to save his people, exactly what Christ did. He died to save us. His blood washes our sins away.
Verse 41. "The men of Nineveh shall rise in judgment with this generation and shall condemn it, because they repented at the preaching of Jonas. And behold, a greater than Jonas is here." Of course, Jesus Christ is God in the flesh.
And if you're not going to listen to Christ, to God, when he's right in front of you, you're not going to listen to any prophet.
Verse 42. "The queen of the south shall rise up in judgment with this generation and shall condemn it. For she came from the uttermost parts of the earth to hear the wisdom of Solomon. And behold, a greater than Solomon is here." Christ is here.
This is the queen of Sheba, and it's written in 1 Kings chapter 10. Yeah, it's 1 Kings chapter 10, I'm pretty sure. And she traveled miles to see Solomon, to see the greatness of his temple and the wisdom Solomon had. You go back a few chapters, 1 Kings chapter 3, God tells Solomon that. He says, "In all your wisdom, there has never been one like you, and there will never be one again." So the queen of Sheba sought out that great wisdom of Solomon, which of course that wisdom was all given from God. But see, these people, they didn't have to travel. Christ is right in front of them. And they still won't listen. Christ mentions this because she traveled far and wide to hear this wisdom. They have Christ right in front of them. They refuse to hear wisdom. They refuse to hear the word of God.
Verse 43. "When the unclean spirit is gone out of a man, he walketh through dry places, seeking rest, and findeth none." That's what happens if an evil spirit gets cast out. But then, and remember, you have that power in Christ's name.
If you do come to a situation where you need to cast a demon out, always remember to say, "Get out in the name of Jesus Christ," and go back to where you came from.
But then listen to God's word, verse 44. "Then he saith," the evil spirit saith, "I will return into my house from whence I came out," saying, "I'm going to return into that body. And when he has come, he findeth it empty, swept, and garnished."
The man is still empty because he never accepted Jesus Christ. Yeah, the spirit got cast out of him, but if that happens and then they refuse to accept Jesus Christ, then you're vulnerable for that spirit to come right back into you. Don't leave yourself empty. Fill it with the Holy Spirit.
Verse 45, "Then goeth he," the evil spirit, "and taketh with himself seven other spirits more wicked than himself. And they enter in and dwell there. And the last state of that man is worse than the first."
Since you decided not to accept Jesus Christ, this evil spirit went and got seven more spirits more wicked than even he. Seven being completeness. And then they're going to come back into you, and then you are really in a bad state. You are filled with evil spirits because you did not accept Jesus Christ.
Verse 46. This is just a situation that Christ is
teaching about.
Verse 46. And it says, "Even so shall it be also unto this wicked generation."
The last state will be worse than the first, because if they do refuse to worship Jesus Christ, and even we can go all the way to the end of the millennium, if they follow Satan at the end when he's loosed a little season, they will be cast into hell with him.
Verse 46. "While he," this is talking about Christ again, "while he yet talked to the people, behold, his mother and his brethren stood without, desiring to speak with him. Then one said to him, Behold, thy mother and thy brethren stand without, desiring to speak with thee. But he answered and said unto him that told him, Who is my mother and who are my brethren?" Watch the love of Christ in this verse 49.
And he stretched forth his hand toward his disciple, and he said, Behold, my mother and my brethren.
Verse 50, For whosoever shall do the will of my Father which is in heaven, the same is my brother and sister and mother.
Do you understand that God is the closest relative that you have? When you do the will of God, you become the brother, the sister, the mother of Jesus Christ, of God Himself. You become a part of that family, and God loves you so much. He created you for His pleasure, as it's written in Revelation chapter 4. He created every one of you exactly how He wanted you, because He loves you. And when you love the Lord back, He makes it so worth your while. You receive such great blessings in this world, and you will receive such great blessings in the world to come, which lasts for all eternity.
Let's go to Father's throne. Dear Father in heaven, Yahweh, thank you so much for giving us this house that we can study your word in. Thank you for bringing us together so we can fellowship with you and so we can learn the truth of your word and cast away the traditions of men that we may have been taught. Thank you for giving us eyes to see and ears to hear so we can understand your word. Thank you for giving us the wisdom and the love directly from you that we so desire. Thank you, Father. In Jesus, Yeshua's precious name, amen.
This recording was done at Smyrna Christian Church, 1623 North Purdom, Kokomo, Indiana. Come join Pastor Jesse Sisk on Sunday mornings at 10 a.m. and Wednesday, Thursdays, and Fridays at 7 p.m. God bless.